At this time, we will have the pouring of the libation by Sister Ifeyomi and Company.
Good evening. How's everyone doing this evening? That's right, give it up. Give it up for yourselves for being here. And we're gonna give it up for the spirit of the ancestors, right? That live through us, right? We are the latest version of our ancestors. And so with that being said, I'm gonna ask you to join me in calling in the spirit of our ancestors. Ibashe Egungun. So, Ibashe in the Yoruba language means I salute you. Egungun simply means to go back and forth. You see, we are all reincarnated spirits of our ancestors. And so as such, Ifa teaches us that if we go back seven generations, we will know who we reincarnated as in our family lineage. And so with that being said, I am going to call in the spirit of the ancestors. First of all, allow me to introduce myself. I am humbled to be standing here on this stage before you today. My name is Ifeyomi Stanton. I am a Yoruba, Egungun, Oshun, and Yemoja priestess here in Las Vegas. The West Las Vegas Arts Center and the West Las Vegas Library Theater is my home. I have history and nostalgia here. And I'm grateful to be here standing before you today on the 10th anniversary of Kemet in the Desert. Please give it up for the ancestor, Franklin G. Verley. Ibai, Ibai, Nitu, Nu. Ashe. And so, the spirits of our ancestors, the spirits of all ancestors, speak to us in many ways. They speak to us in our dreams. They even speak to us in our waking hours. And we speak to them back. Some people call it speaking in tongues. Some people call it speaking another language. Nevertheless, the ancestors know and understand all the languages. Ashe? So there is no wrong way to talk to your ancestors, to call in your ancestors. And as Africans here in America, it is our birthright and it is our duty to constantly uphold, revere, and honor our ancestors. And so with that being said, Egungun, Kiki Egungun, Eguniku, Wanran Fea Wo Kuo Pipi, Oda Sobofunle Wo Eguniku Batabago Egunde, Bia Bafatorina Leguna Shedeo Ashe. What did I just say? Praise to the mediums of the ancestors. Ancestors who have preserved the mystery of featherless flight. You create the words of reverence and power. The drums of the ancestors announce the arrival of the ancestors. On the strong mat, you spread your power. The ancestors are here. Hey, give it up for the drummer. Obashango Wale. Giving praise and paying honor to our ancestors. Just a brief note, in the prayer I said, the drums of the ancestors announce the arrival of the ancestors. What that means is every time we play those drums, whether it's the African drums, whether it's the bongo drums, whether it's the trap drums, whether it's the Congo drums, we are calling in the spirit of our ancestors. For those of you who don't know, if you look at all of the other indigenous cultures, the Japanese, the Chinese, they all play drums. The Native American Indians, they play drums to honor their ancestors. Another sacred thing that we do to honor our ancestors is we pour libation. Libation sometimes is water, right? In its purest form, this is a very powerful element. Sometimes they use milk, and sometimes there is real libations involved, right? There's a reason why it's called wine and spirits. And so for the young people out there that have seen the younger people or the people older than them pouring a little bit out for their homies, they're honoring the ancestors. Ashe? Ibashe, Bogbo, Ire, Omitutu. Omitutu, Ana Tutu, Ile Tutu, Tutu Loroye, Kosi Ku, Kosi Erun, Kosi Eo, Kosi Ofo, Kosi Akoba, Kosi Dana, Kosi Pitubo, Oriku Babawa, Mojuba, Gunin Blisi, Olo Dumare, Oloye, Orun, Mojuba, Bogbo, Orisha, Ibashe, Iami, Yamoja, Omibomi, Ibashe Iami o reye ye o shun to sing. Mojuba bogbo Ianifa Moju ba bo bo babalao. Moju ba bo bo yelosha. Moju ba bo bo babalosha. Moju ba bo bo matasanto. Moju ba bo bo patasanto. Moju ba bo bo egunti mi olodu mare oloye oro. Moju ba sunrise. Moju ba sunset. Moju ba 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 arumi lai fao so dogbe. Moju ba 400 arumi le. Moju ba akoda. Moju ba aseda. Moju ba awani ami o saranga. Moju ba to all of the honored ancestors who now sit at the feet of Olodumare God in the life that follows this one. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who were buried in the soil of Alkibulan, Africa. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who came across the waters of the Atlantic Ocean, Omiyo, during the transatlantic slave trade. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who lost their lives coming across the waters of the Atlantic Ocean during the transatlantic slave trade, Omiyo. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who lost their lives on the floors, behind the gates, and in the dungeons of the Doors of No Return. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who are indigenous of this continent. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors who died on this continent. Moju ba my mother, Thelma Lee Johnson Stanton Batesy, bye-bye, Nichanu. Moju ba my father, Lavelle Samuel Smokey Stanton Jr., ibai ibai ni tunu. Moju ba to the spirit of Franklin G. Verley, the visionary behind Kimmin in the Desert, ibai ibai ni tunu. Moju ba to Brother Renako Rashidi, ibai ibai ni tunu. Moju ba to all of the honored ancestors of Mr. Oscar Robinson. Moju ba all of the honored ancestors to the staff of Kimmin in the Desert, the musicians, all of the performers. Moju ba to all of the honored ancestors of the staff of the West Las Vegas Library Theater and the West Las Vegas Arts Center for being pillars in the community. And last but not least, moju ba to all of the honored ancestors for everyone who found it in their spirit to make it here tonight for this 10th anniversary of Kimmin in the Desert. We say ashe, 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 ashe. Ibashe to the spirit of our ancestors. I thank you. Odabo.
Habarigani, I am Dr. Al Gurrier, just a moment, sister, and for the past 30 years, as I've celebrated Kwanzaa in this community, we always begin with the African tradition of pouring libation. Well, the libation experience that was shared with you this evening was one of the most unique and comprehensive that I've seen in my 30 years of celebrating in this community. Ashe, and another hand for my beautiful black sister here. Thank you, darling. Thank you very much. And in the African tradition, we as griots, and of course, I'm sure you are all aware and remember that back in Africa, we didn't have CNN or television or social media. So how did the people in Africa get the word around? It was the griot who went around from community to community. And each time was a unique, separate celebration of our history and our culture. That's how it was then, and that's what we've got to find ways of getting back to today, because we cannot expect any other individual, institution, or organization to do for us what we must do for ourselves. And so, ladies and gentlemen, in the African tradition, I welcome you to our celebration of Kemet in the Desert 2023. And it is in recognition and praise of our founding brother who has transitioned, who we all who will participate in the show today will share some remembrance of his contribution to this activity this evening. I'm disappointed. I was here last night. I was disappointed last night because we didn't have a standing room audience, but tonight we do. And so I'm sure you're ready to begin. So in the African tradition, we begin with Habarigani. Habarigani. Thank you and welcome. It is indeed my honor and privilege to be a part of this presentation today that for the last 10 years I have sat where you sat and enjoyed the presentation of some of the most profound and prolific minds in African culture and history as they have graced our stages of Kemet in the Desert. Like the late Dr. Renuka Rashiki, Jawanza Kinjufa, James Smalls, Leonard Jeffries, Yusef Solomon, Anthony Browder. And tonight, it is my pleasure later to introduce a young man who, as I thought about how I might introduce him tonight, I said, maybe it would be appropriate if I would say to my audience that tonight I am going to be introducing the contemporary Marcus, Malcolm, Mandela, and you will find more as we go along in our program this evening. As I've shared with you, I've been in this community for near 35 years. And there's one point that I would be remiss if I failed to share with you this beautiful facility that we are in this evening. As you walked in the door, there was a list of names of elected official, primarily light-skinned politicians who in some way laid a small part in the construction of this building. But ladies and gentlemen, there was a group, and that group consisted of Doris Harris, Doug Johnson, Marie Jordan, Colonel Thomas Lear, Mrs. Edna Perkins, Attorney Barbara Robinson, Juanita Simpson, David Washington, and Wendell P. Williams, with a staff assistant, a young lady named Joyce Thomas, and Dr. Al Gurrier, went to the library board and said, "We need a place for us to perform our culture." And as a committee, we petitioned the city and the library district, and we got this building built. And on the 25th anniversary of this building, as I was conducting a Kwanzaa, I paid tribute to the persons who helped to build this building. And I appealed to the library district to put a plaque up recognizing those African Americans who went down the street to the Charleston Library and said, "Oh no, no, we're not having," and this is a fact, "you're not building a building with one stall in the men's bathroom for us when down the street on Charleston, you have a bathroom with 4 stalls. Go back to the drawing board. You got to do better. And that's the process we went through to get this building built. So let's give a round of applause to the tremendous staff led by Ms. China Hudson and all of our people who are hosting us here tonight. I also have as a responsibility tonight to recognize some of the sponsors who have helped to make our program a success. And of course, I'd be remiss while I don't spend as much time as I'd like in this home that I consider my child. I do spend most of my time with my Sankofas and Kwanzas next door in the great West Las Vegas Arts Center, and I'd like to ask you to give a round of applause for Dr. Marcia Robinson, Lisa Russell, and her staff there. We'd also like to say a special thank you to the brothers of Self-Rep, who are members of the new Black Panther Party, who will be providing security for our guests this evening. For a young man I love, and I am honored by him when he tells people I am his mentor, and he'll be a part of our program later, the founder of Stretch for Change. Minister Stretch Sanders will be here. We'd also like to thank KUNV 91.5 FM and their general manager, Mr. Riddle. Also, we would like to thank Nate Sutton and Mr. and Mrs. Terry Harris for their generous contributions. In addition, we would like to thank the Coalition of 100 Black Women of Las Vegas. And we'd like to extend our deepest condolence to that organization for the transition of their founding president, Dr. Sandra Mack. If you weren't here last night, you missed a beautiful program. It was a tribute to Black women. And our speaker was outstanding, and she named every Black emperor in Europe. She named the emperor who had people thought she was a man. But she stepped forward because she knew that she was the person for the job, put on the mantle of an African king and called herself King of Egypt. You missed it last night, but it was a great program. Let's give our presenters from last night a big round of applause. We'd like to give special thanks to Chief Stacy Dugan, the CEO of Simply Pure Catering, our videographer for this evening, Mr. Daniel Thompson, our photographer, Ms. Celeste Holmes, and for one of our sponsors, Ms. Reba Labatt. Now it's time for me to take some personal privilege and talk about a couple of gentlemen that you all need to know a little more about. The first gentleman was born in Memphis, Tennessee, where he grew up. And he attended Shaw University, one of the oldest Black higher educational institutions in the HBCU circuit. He was a theater major there. He came to Las Vegas toward the end of the 20th century, and right away got very involved in creating programs and activities in the original library. I'm very well aware of that space because it's where I first started conducting Kwanzas. And for those of you who are not familiar with the physical structure of this facility, in the library there are 2 small conference rooms. If you've been here long enough, you know it was the place where this community expected us all to cram into to do whatever cultural thing we had to do. Well, back around 1990, that's when we decided that we really didn't have enough space to do our thing. And that group that I mentioned earlier got together and began to put pressure on the city and the library district, and this facility was the result. Well, one of the persons who I met during that period was this young man from Memphis, Tennessee. And he used to conduct activities in room A or room B. And for me, I have come to call this guy the Tyler Perry of Las Vegas. Because Oscar Robertson writes, produces, and stars in every one of the Kemet in the Desert program since Franklin G. founded it in 2013. After the end of the first year, he decided he needed some help, so he turned to the premier production presenter in this community, and he and Oscar Robertson together teamed up and made the Kemet and the Desert what we see tonight. When Franklin started, he had a company. He called it Nia Production. And Oscar, as I've indicated, had been producing programs in room A and B in the library. Well, around 1991, Oscar decided to develop and create the first professional black acting company in this community. And in 1995, when we opened this building, the library district commissioned Oscar Robertson and his Platinum Production Company to be the first company to perform a presentation, and if I remember correctly, it was called
The Cabaret.
Thank you, Oscar. Give him a big round of applause. So Oscar Robertson has continued to be an integral part of this great activity and of creating and sharing his talent and entertaining this community. So the first person I'm recognizing tonight, and I'm asking you to give him another big round of applause, our producer for the Kemet in the Desert, Oscar Robertson. When I came to Las Vegas, I felt that I had identified a void that existed in the community also. So in 1992, I created a program called the Southern Nevada Black Cultural Awareness Society. And that year, we brought to the Las Vegas Valley the foremost Africologist ever to live. His name was Dr. Yusef Augustus Ben-Yakan. And we brought Dr. Ben-Yakan here to Las Vegas. A few years later, and this was after the turn of the 20th century, I was invited to be a guest on KCEP. The name of the program was Tell It Like It Is Radio. And the gentleman who invited me to talk about my work with Dr. Ben was none other than the late Franklin G. Verley. He was a jewel. He was a beautiful, genuine, compassionate human being. And as a teacher and a principal who has been inducted into the Clark County School District Hall of Fame, if I had to hire anybody, I would hire a Franklin G. to teach in my school. Because of his compassion and understanding and love for black people. And he shared with me that he was going to start the Kemet in the Desert program. I had the pleasure of meeting and chatting with Franklin on numerous occasions. He invited me to his home. And he created this wonderful venue to afford us the opportunity of getting the real CRT. Because you see, what we're doing here tonight and what Franklin G. and Oscar Robinson have been doing for the last 10 years is critical race teaching, because it's teaching our history and our culture. I am a product of the Eurocentric system of education. Yes, I have a doctorate degree, but that DR in front of my name means that I am dead to black people. Because if the prestigious institution of higher learning would have had any idea that I would be standing before you tonight sharing these comments, there's no way in hell they would have given me a doctorate degree. And I say that if you know anybody else with a doctorate degree, you extend your sympathy to them. Because if they have a doctorate degree, that means that the dominant white culture has agreed that they have become white. Because the system of education in place in this country is designed solely and exclusively for the aggrandizement of the white Anglo-Saxon male Protestant. And if you ascend to the terminal degree, the only way you get it, if you prove to them you are white. If you have a doctorate degree, it's called a terminal degree. And if you have a terminal degree, then that should say to you that you have now got to begin the journey to begin knowledge of self. And Dr. Gurrier says, and I felt so good last night as I sat in the audience, because every slide that our presenter put on the screen last night had these words on it: know thyself. And as you depart here tonight, if you don't remember any of the verbiage that Dr. Gurrier shared, I want you to remember one thing. This is my quote. There is no more potent or powerful knowledge that you can acquire in life than knowledge of self. And so with that knowledge, it is my pleasure to present to some and introduce to others the executive producing director of the Kemet in the Desert program. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a rousing greeting to Mr. Oscar Robinson.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. Thank you so much. At this time, we will present the Franklin G's City of Las Vegas Proclamation honoree. And this year's proclamation goes to Miss Lisa Russell. Give it up to her. Come on, Lisa, you in the house? Give it up. Come on, Lisa. Give it up for her.
Come on,
can we go here? Lisa, you've been working in the community for over 20 years. You've done so much for so long with so little, you're not qualified to do anything with nothing. And today, Las Vegas, February the 18th, 2023, it's Lisa Russell Day, y'all. Celeste? Come on, man. Kodak moment. Okay, you have to say a few words if you like. Go to the podium.
Oh. Ooh. Well, thank you so much. The pressure. I'm not usually on this side of the theater, so please bear with me. But I want to say I thank you and appreciate you so much. The community, I love the community. That's what, you know, I love to serve and us to, you know, give back to everyone that supports the West Las Vegas Arts Center, the West Las Vegas Library Theater, and I can truly say I love my job. It's like, so, you know, it comes natural, it's just easy, so it doesn't even feel like a job, but it is, because we work hard. But I wanna say thank you so much. I appreciate you once again, and my heart is full. This is very definitely an honor, and I appreciate you for, you know, thinking about me and feeling that I do deserve something.
We love you, Lisa.
Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you guys.
Thank you, baby. Now, at this time, we have a special presentation. It's going to be introduced by Minister Stretch Sanders. Please receive him.
I keep telling the library to get this stand for 610, brothers. Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Minister Stretch Sanders, and I have the honor to introduce a special presentation in honor of Franklin G. Can we just give Franklin G another warm hand in his honor, the visionary behind this event? But I would like to introduce a special presentation in honor of Franklin G from Senator Jackie Rosen's office, presented by Julia Coleman. Please give her a hand as she comes at this time.
Everybody. My name is Julia Coleman. I am a regional representative for Senator Jackie Rosen. Unfortunately, Senator Rosen could not be here with us tonight, so I'm here on her behalf. Before I join the team, I'd like to say I've been in this community for 15 years. I've been actually across the street over at Nevada Partners in a group called The Gathering, which we have pioneered along with Rodney Smith, Sam Smith, Alex Cherub, and also Dr. Theodore Ranshaw. So I know there's a lot of my friends in this theater tonight, and I want to say thank you for inviting us here tonight. It is a pleasure and an honor to be able to present this award for Franklin. Oscar is gonna be accepting this award for Franklin, but I wanted to say that Franklin was such a huge spirit. When he would come into the gathering, he would just light up the space that we're in. He's always wanting to provide us with education, encouraging us to always continue to be a mentor to the youths, and also always, always understanding where we came from. He used to always say, you don't know who you are unless you know where you came from. That was something he used to always say. And I love that. He always wanted for us to know our roots, and I appreciate him for that. I've learned a lot over the years. So I'm here tonight, and this is long overdue, to provide Franklin with a certificate of special congressional recognition for being posthumously honored as founder of Kemet in the Desert at its 10th annual celebration of Black history. We remember your legacy and recognize your dedication and service to your community. We love you. Thank you.
This is a Kodak moment. I am honored and humbled to accept this on behalf of Kim in the Desert, our board of directors, and the Verley family. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
And give our regards to the senator. Okay, thank you, sister. Thank you. Now, at this time, we're going to do a video tribute to our beloved Franklin G, and then we're going to get this party started. You hear me? Kick it.
Brothers, I say, he has risen, he will rise again. Amen. To my Jewish brothers, shalom. To my Buddhist brothers, namaste. Is that the right way to say that? To my extraterrestrial brothers, may the force be with you. There's some Star Wars folks out there. And you know, to my Rastas, you know, free the land, all God and most, all praises due from the God of the Most High. And to the rest of y'all, what's up?
These are slave shackles. Every one of us who's melanated has somebody that brought us here, related to us, that looked like us, that was imprisoned in these. Every melanated soul on these shores and through most of the continental Americas, including the Caribbean, this is what binds us, these slave shackles. And you'll notice these slave shackles are closed. There's a lock on them. That means that the last soul that was in these slave shackles is still there. Make sure that as long as I have these opportunities to talk to city council and use the platform or the radio station, that we get some kudos from our folks. So today, the city proclamation is for Brother Asani. Today's probably because I want to recognize who you are and how you say it, but today, Las Vegas, it's China Hudson Day. This Memphis brother here has been my brother through the time and the efforts that I put through and many of the things and endeavors that I've done, and he did it before. He opened this movie, he opened this theater. He had the first set of plays here, he brought black culture, not that it hadn't been brought, but he restored black culture here in Las Vegas, because we know that all those great actors and actresses who were on the stage on the strip was black culture, even though they couldn't stay in those hotels. Red Fox was black culture. Luther Franklin, black culture. Robinson is black culture here in Las Vegas. So I believe in giving people their flowers. We have a city proclamation for Mr. Robinson, because he came back and he does this for us. He puts this, I may stand here and get the folks together, and I ain't gonna lie, I make some of the investments. Mr. Robinson does the work. And we have a city proclamation that makes today Oscar Robinson Day. Signed by Al Rico.
Thank you.
This brother does the work. And I, Councilman Barlow, when I came for the proclamation, he says, Mr. Furley, you realize that you've placed four, now five, African Americans on the Nevada State Legislation Registry for eternity. And I was like, no, I ain't got no more warrants, do I? Was, He said, no, but when we do make a day of a proclamation, it stays on the Nevada Registry forever. So we've had Renoka Rashidi, Dr. Renoka Rashidi, Dr. Leonard Jeffries, Dr. James Small. We also had Yusef Salam, and now Oscar Robinson. His name will be in perpetuity in the state of Nevada forever for the work that he's done here at this theater and in this community. He has restored Black culture. See, Black history didn't just start in this continent. It's the beginning of time. And I gotta say hi to my Greek family out there. Welcome back. Yeah, the Divine Nine. I know you're in the place to be, but welcome back. Because everything the Divine Nine stood for was taken from them. They took it off the room, excuse me, they took it off the walls in Egypt. So while you may be Greek in letters, you're Egyptian in thought. So welcome home. That's coming out of the darkness, y'all. But as I said, what we're gonna have tonight is that message. There's a message in the music. You may not understand Kanye Tiller. I can't hear the Migos mumbling either. But I know what Marvin Gaye was talking about. I know what Bob Marley was talking about. I know what Eddie James was talking about. I know what wave in the water means. There's a message in our music, and it always has. That's American on this continent. It's the beginning of blues. It's the beginning of jazz. It's the beginning, definitely, of hip hop. And don't think that that Jim Crow era stopped any of that Motown flavor that Aretha Franklin said. Respect, respect. And now they're singing it harder than us, huh? All right, now I'm gonna leave that alone because we still you know, we're Black history. But Mr. Robinson has put together this project with these people. And I hope you understand what they're gonna try to convey to you is to take this armor, come out of the darkness. Our elected officials sometimes are in darkness. Our families are in darkness. The things we see and the things that our children are watching continue to keep us in the darkness. Be like Dr. King. Come out of the darkness, and that's all he wanted us to do. So tonight, without any further ado, I place you in the most capable hands of my brother. And I mean that, because he owed me money. All right, now y'all know, I ain't asking for it back. I'm just telling you, he owed me, so that's how you know he's my brother. And he was my friend, I'll be like, well, you seen him? No. My brother can hold on to my money because what he does in the contrary of people up here do, I cannot do. It's opening our soul to give us the humanity we need to fortify us and to become armor in this cloudy time. Without any further ado, it's been my pleasure and I look forward to seeing you again soon. This is the 6th Annual Kemet in the Desert Series, 2019. Mr. Oscar Robinson will take you and enjoy. And get some sunshine in your face.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the 10th Annual Kemet in the Desert, Black Weekend 2023, baby! As we continue to elevate and celebrate and advance the legacy of our founder, my brother, my partner, and my friend, Franklin G. Verley. I'm Oscar Robinson, your host. Good evening. Kemet in the Desert was created to enlighten and awaken the community by bringing to Las Vegas a master teachers of African and Egyptian history, religion, and culture, and we will certainly do that tonight. We have a great show for you, so hold on tight with all your might as we elevate and celebrate my brother tonight. In order to keep hope alive, we present to you the groovement and the soulful movement of the sensational dance ensemble, Studio 305. Give it up! It's going down, baby, baby!
Throw me in the landfill. Don't think about the consequences. Throw me in the dirt pit. Don't think about the choices that you make. Throw me in the water. Don't think about the splash I will create. Leave me at the altar, knowing all the things you just escaped. Push me out to sea on a little boat that you made out of the evergreen that you helped your father cut away. Leave me on the tracks to wait until the morning train arrives. Don't you dare look back. Walk away, catch up with the sun.
that hides the glow of a rose. But what good am I? What good am I? Heaven only knows.
Smile on the infant bell. your seat belts, please. We're about to land in Havana. Yeah! And I scream.
What you scream?
Don't bother me, cause I can't cope.
Yeah!
I don't care if we are aloft. Stop this plane and let me get off. No hablo Española, baby, cause I can't cope.
She said don't bother her.
I don't mean to make a fuss.
She can't cope.
Next time I'ma catch the bus.
My boss lady was smiling when she said, now listen, LMA, you're not giving me a full day's work while you took two coffee breaks today.
Say what?
I smiled back.
Yeah.
That's right, sugar. It helps me cope.
Woo!
I also did four laundry loads and I ironed them too.
I ironed them too.
I washed the carpet, washed the blinds, top job. Then I took Junior to the playground.
That brat.
I didn't mind a bit.
Uh-huh.
But I'll do better tomorrow.
Why?
Cause today I quit.
Ooh. All right.
Yes.
Go find yourself another workhorse, honey. Cause I can't cope.
She said don't bother her.
I ain't just lame.
Cause she can't cope.
You better mop that for yourself.
That's
all right.
Right
now.
Peace of mind.
Uh-huh.
But I could tell by the look on his face that his job was becoming a grind.
Not you again. I can't cope. Now I know you got troubles, but I've got a few. So let me lie on the couch and talk to you. In the city, we never went out after dark. We had three cars, but no place to park. So we started commuting and they raised all the tolls. Now they're trying to plug up my tax loophole. My son's smoking crack when I asked him why. He said, crack or martinis, pa. We're both getting high. My daughter announced that I had a grandson when I asked about the father.
What'd she say?
She said, who needs one?
What?
My wife's liberated, now the house has two heads. We eat out every night, and she ordered twin beds.
I said, hold it, mister. I can't cope. Your reservation has reduced me to tears. You got enough problems to last you for years. Between yours and mine, it's hard to keep track. Are you a small psychiatrist, but you miss
this fact that you gotta cope. I gotta cope. All God's children gotta cope. Yeah.
I don't need
creeping under my bed. Woo! All I need.
I need
less fat, back, more green back, and you off my back.
Hit it, Woody!
Woo! All right now.
Woo!
Ah.
Woo! Woo!
Come on, Woody.
Get it out! Them off the stage, but tonight they will get their due. Come on, cast! Working with me when she was 25 years old in 1995. Lisa was in the original cast of the Cabaret when we opened this theater in 1995. Give it up. This is Sharmika Davis. Give it up, folks. This is Zakiya Smith. Zakiya has been working with me since she was 13 years old. How are you, Zakiya?
16 now.
Zakiya received her first professional payment through Platinum Productions last year. So, Zakiya, you are now a professional. So, moving forward, you are not to do any free shows. They have to pay you, baby. You are a professional, henceforth, now and forever. Amen. You tell them I said you were pro. This is Deja. Deja is our production manager. Deja is Alicia's cousin. Deja started working with me last year when she was 25 years old. One year, I did Kimmin in the Desert, and a young lady walked up to me and she said, "You don't remember who I am?" She said, "But 20 years ago, when I was 13 years old, I was in a pageant, and you helped me with a poem in that pageant. And because you helped me, I won the pageant." This is my daughter. She's 13 years old. I wanted her to meet you. See, when you live in your purpose, you don't know how you affect people. You hear me?
Amen. Yeah.
This right here, little baby.
Yes!
I saw her. She's from Memphis. Shari's from Memphis. I saw her dancing on his board about 3-4 years ago. I told her mama, I'm gonna put her in this show. Her mama didn't believe me. You see, she's here, don't you? Wasn't she marvelous? Give it up for her. Woo! All right.
Riley.
Did I forget anybody?
Yes.
Who I forget?
He just saved me.
Come here, Riley. I can never forget Riley. Riley is something special. She's a triple threat. She dances, she can sing, and she's an actress. Woo! Riley is a producer and a director already. She's on the stage trying to tell me what to do. If I'm not careful, she'll take over the rehearsal. But baby, I say this to you publicly. You don't have to take it. I'm gonna groom you up. And in about 10 years, I'm gonna give it to you. Woo! Dr. Anthony Browder told me last year, he said, "Brother, train your replacement. Well, you're looking at him."
It's all right.
We have to pass the baton to the next generation.
Amen. Yeah.
Thank you, Riley. Woo! Cash, you may exit the stage. Y'all all right? We got a great ending for you. Hold on tight with all your might. Because you are now enrolled in Kemet in the Desert University. Kemet means black. And the blacker the college, the sweeter the knowledge, baby. Let's get ready to rumble! Keynote speakers procession, Kemet in the Desert, African Dance Ensemble. Give it up! Come on, brother.
Earlier this evening, I mentioned that we were having a very special guest with us this evening that I felt is very rapidly and will very soon be known around the world as one of the marvelous men of African American history and culture. And he would be joining his predecessors, Marcus Muhammad, Malcolm, Medgar, Martin, and Mandela. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce the most sought after African speaker on this continent. He has spoken on every continent except Australia. He is a doctor, but he's got that DR that made him realize that he had to go back and fetch it. He had to go through the process of Sankofa and retrieve his history and his culture and his knowledge of self so that he could be here today to present to you the pure African. This gentleman is prepared. He is a doctor of clinical psychology. As a practice, he is a school psychologist. He is an expert in the education and mental health of Black youth, and especially in the area of special education. He is the author of books, Black Parent Advocate, and Psychoacademic Holocaust. This brother is heavy, and you can see almost his life story that he's not responsible for. Other people have taken his presentations, which have been so profound, and have put them on YouTube. If you've got a day tomorrow, I recommend you sit down and really get a chance to absorb the wonderful knowledge that this brother has to share. He's going to share some of that with us tonight. And he's going to share with you one of his visions that I'll talk a little more about. The formation of the FDMG Academy, that I want to encourage all of you to go online and find out how you can make a contribution to be supportive of this most noble effort. He is going to practice what we preach. The griots speak. But we've got to do more than speak. This gentleman is establishing a school for Black boys. And I challenge you to find ways to be supportive of him in that effort. As I've indicated, he has spoken all over the world. He speaks about being unapologetically African. And as a matter of fact, this summer he'll be doing a tour around the United States, and he's calling it his Unapologetically African Tour. He is being called the Prince of Pan-Africanism. He conducts a teleconference once a week, a nationwide conference where he shares information, knowledge, experience, and expertise, because like myself, this guy's been a school principal. That means we've been in the trenches. So he knows where it's at and what it's all about. And he's going to share some of that information with you tonight. He's actually started a national organization. It's called the National Independent Black Parents Association. And the one thing that we need most in this world today, as a researcher and a practitioner and a teacher and a preacher, I have come to the conclusion that the number one problem that we have as a race The human race is what I've come to define as the dying art of parenting. And for the last 50 years, I've been preaching all over the United States that we've got to find way of involving and enfranchising parents. And our presenter today is doing that. He's building things. And that's what we need to find more of in our culture and our society. African people who know and understand themselves, who are willing to do things and build things. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to present the builder who is about to build the FDMG. Now, that could be confusing. So if you don't mind, I'd like to just take a second. FD. Okay. Wait. Thank you for humoring me. I am the introductory teacher. The master teacher will be up shortly. In the meantime, I want to tell you, if I take the liberty, just a few seconds to tell you about F.D., Frederick Douglass, born in 1817. He was the most prolific African-American of the 19th century. So profound and unique was this man's reading and writing. It is his reading and writing that he shared with people all over the world about the experiences he had in slavery. From the white man who was his father, called Captain Anthony, and how Captain Anthony used to beat his aunt till her black bled. This brother here, I know what FD means, because he is a kinsman of Frederick Douglass, the first African-American to run for the presidency of these United States. And he is a mentor of our teacher this evening. The other mentor is another love of mine, born in Jamaica, where our founder, Franklin G's parents, both his mother's parents and his father's parents, came from Jamaica. And they moved to Harlem, New York. And guess what person was a significant influence on the parents' life of Brother Franklin Verley? It was a guy by the name of M.G., Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey didn't come to the United States until 1916. And he was only in this country for a period of 10 years, but became one of the most prolific leaders of one of the largest African movements ever created in this country. He lived in New York. It was called the Back to Africa Movement. Frederick Douglass, FD, and Marcus Garvey, MG Academy, is what is being started by this gentleman in honor of his two mentors. And so, without any further delay, brother, I apologize for cutting into your time. But ladies and gentlemen, let's greet with an African Harambe, Brother Umar Johnson.
Las Vegas, Nevada. Make some noise, black family, one time. Before I go any further, brothers and sisters, I learned earlier tonight that we are in the presence of an elder, a queen mother, who is the first black principal in the state of Nevada. Can we turn the light up one time on the Queen Mother Elder. Can we turn the light up one time? Where's she at? Stand up, Queen Mother. Everybody stand up. Everybody stand up. Is the mic on?
I got some on.
Yes, indeed. We honor the ancestors, and after the ancestors, we honor the elders. Brothers and sisters, I was doing some reading today about the state of education in the city of Las Vegas. And I saw some rather disturbing statistics in the news. It said that the black children in Las Vegas are about 15 to 30% of the student body, but they account for 80% of all school expulsions. I read in the paper that from kindergarten through eighth grade, only about 10% of the black children in Las Vegas are proficient in language, and only about 3.9% are proficient in mathematics. So, I said to myself, these statistics are some of the worst I've seen in the country, brothers and sisters. I want to be real clear about something, and I need you to understand this. When we talk about the miseducation of black children, I need you to get something. I need you to know that our failure, our children's failure, is not due to poverty. It's not due to the incarcerated black father. It's not due to the single black mother. It's not due to gangster rap. It's not due to wanting to be a football player, a basketball player. It's not purely due to academic disinterest. But the biggest reason why black children struggle in Las Vegas and across the state of Nevada is because in order for the white power structure to preserve privileges for white boys and girls, I said in order for the white power structure to preserve privilege for white boys and girls, I said in order for the white power structure of Nevada to preserve privilege for white boys and girls, black children must be miseducated. It is not an accident, brothers and sisters. It is intentional, it is by decree, and it will not change until you change it. There's nothing more disturbing than watching black children get blamed for the lack of interest of their classroom teachers. What is the number one predictor of success in the classroom? Is it the amount of money we spend on the children? No. Is it the amount of money we pay the teachers? No. Is it the education of the parents? No, it's not. The number one predictor of academic success in the classroom is the teacher's belief that the children can learn. The teacher's belief that the children can learn. And I'll be the first to tell you, yes, there's good white language teachers, and there's good white math teachers, and there's good white science teachers, and there's good white social studies teachers. Can white people teach an academic course? Of course they can. I've met great white teachers. But what we need to understand, and the reason why psychologists such as myself would argue that black children will never thrive in school. See, they survive in school, but they don't thrive in school. And one of the reasons black children don't thrive in school is they need a black teacher in order to teach them, because the job of the black teacher is not just to teach them how to read. It's not just to teach them how to count. It's not just to teach them science and social studies, but the job of the black teacher, and only the black teacher can do it, they have to teach the black boy and girl how to survive racism. Because if you don't know how to survive racism, no matter what else you learn will benefit you. So the reason black children need black teachers is so they know how to survive racism. Brothers and sisters, do you know that the public schools did not desegregate in 54 to give our children a better education? That's not why the Supreme Court overturned Brown in 54. The reason the Supreme Court overturned Brown in 54 is they were growing concerned. at the quality of education black children were getting from those segregated, dilapidated black schoolhouses. See, those black schoolhouses didn't have the best building. They didn't have the best books. They didn't have the best furniture. They didn't have the best academic aids. But you know what they had? Black teachers who would rather die than see their children fail. See, one thing we got to get tonight, Black Nevada, one thing we have to understand was that we invented the gas mask before we sat next to white kids. One thing we gotta understand, we invented the walkie-talkie before we sat next to white kids. We invented the self-lubricating engine before we sat next to white children. Most of the critical inventions of this country came out of the minds of black people who never sat next to a white child. The purpose of school desegregation was not to improve the education of black children, but to dumb it down. And they've dumbed it all the way down to where our boys no longer are sitting around like Lewis Latimer figuring out ways to keep them lights on overnight. They're no longer sitting around like Granville T. Woods trying to figure out telegraphic communication. They've turned in the science for basketball. They've turned in the mathematics for football. They have stripped our children of their black imaginations. The purpose of a school is not to tell you what to think. The purpose of a school is to turn on your internal genius so you will learn what to think. See, one of the big things missing from education of black children is they are totally disconnected from the melanin factor. And what do I mean when I say our children are disconnected from the melanin factor? I'm saying that if we want black excellence from black children, we have to connect the color of their skin to the intellectual power of their soul. Until we restore divinity to the complexion of black children, we'll never get black excellence. See, you have to activate melanin in the African child. You have to activate melanin. And public school doesn't activate melanin, it deactivates melanin. See, our skin color is not just the complexion. Our skin color is our divine connection to supreme consciousness. And if you leave it out of the intellectual discourse, you're robbing our children of one of their greatest intellectual gifts. The great black psychologist, Dr. Amos Wilson, who I think was the greatest black scholar of the second half of the 20th century, he wrote a book, Developmental Psychology of the Black Child, that you all need to read. And Dr. Amos, a Garvey Pan-African psychologist just like myself, he went and found studies that proved black children from birth until age 5 outperformed the children of every other race on measures of intelligence. But from age 5 until they graduate high school, the black child's IQ drops every year they go up. That means the longer they in public school, the dumber they tend to become. But I want to be clear. We're going to talk about the racism of the public school system. But we have to talk about the complicity of the Negro community. Because truth be told, we don't value black excellence ourselves. Truth be told, we're more interested in football players than scientists. Truth be told, we value the basketball player more than we value the child who's scoring the highest on the test. See, I can fail every class in Las Vegas, but if I can shoot that basketball, I'll still be a childhood hero. 2 months ago, we celebrated Christmas. But how many of you bought your children books for Christmas? Almost no books in the black home. See, as a therapist who goes into homes, the first thing I look for is a bookshelf. And why do I look for the bookshelf? Because I know the average black child reads 2 grades below their class standing. And I know that if their parents don't make them practice, if their parents don't take them to the library, if their parents don't take them to the bookstore, they'll never catch up. And if a black boy can't read by the time he finishes the fifth grade, there's a 75% chance he'll spend some of his time in prison. So in your house, is there such thing as homework, or is it an endangered species? In your house, is there a such thing as quiet reading hour, or is it an endangered species? In your house, is there such thing as a bookshelf, or is it an endangered species? Is there a dictionary, an encyclopedia, a thesaurus? If your home don't have any reading material inside of it, it's not a house. It's a prison preparation laboratory. See, what I'm trying to say is that we don't make it hard for Las Vegas public schools to miseducate our children, because we support them in that agenda knowingly or unknowingly. I remember once upon a time, I thought the video game was the biggest distractor from academic excellence for black children. It's no longer the video game. It's social media now. Your son or daughter spend 10 hours a day on social media. I'm trying to understand how they got a social media account failing a major subject. I'm trying to understand how there's a video game unit in your house and you got a child failing a major subject. If there's any black home with a video game system and a child failing a major subject, then that's a black parent who's comfortable with academic suicide. And then, when the schools desegregated in 54, white folks said, we're going to start our own schools. And so the biggest explosion in private schools in America came between 54 and 74. Dr. King's civil rights bill came. White folks still wouldn't desegregate them schools. The 1970s came. They started busing black kids into the white schools, but most public school districts refused. So the federal government came up with an idea, and that idea was called special education. And the federal government went to the white school districts of America and said, listen, we know you don't want these black children, but you're making us look bad internationally. So this is what we're going to do, white folks. You're going to take these black children in the front door. Once they get in your school, you can resegregate them again. But don't say you're separating them from the white kids because they're black. Don't say you're separating them from the white kids because they're black. You're going to say you're separating them from the white kids because they're reading disabled. They're math disabled. They're emotionally disturbed. They're ADHD. They're conduct disorder. They're ODD. And so the government came up with all these fancy fake titles to put on black children. And now today in Las Vegas, at least 40% of you have a child taking some form of psychiatric medication. 10 milligrams a day of Ritalin, 5 milligrams a day of Adderall, 6 milligrams of Concerta. Nothing but synthesized crack cocaine. And you're giving your son and daughter crack cocaine so they can sit still long enough to be miseducated by white female teachers. Can I tell you a secret? A child naturally wants to learn. A child naturally shows up in school with the desire to achieve. So the question isn't what's wrong with black children. The question, what is wrong with schools in Las Vegas where the black children don't naturally want to achieve? That's the question that got to be asked. ADHD. We get ADD in 1980, the same year the CIA dropped off crack in the black community. 1987, they added the H, hyperactivity. Do you know what that means, black parents? That means if you take your son or daughter to the psychiatrist for an ADHD evaluation, even if he's not hyper, he will still be classified as such. Because there is no attention deficit disorder anymore. And the reason the word hyperactivity is added to every diagnosis is to justify prescriptions for the drug companies. $30 billion on psychiatric medication. And you know what's so sad about it? Most of our black boys with the ADHD label, the ODD label, the CD label, they don't have no neurological problems. They don't have no psychiatric instabilities. The problem is they live in a house where there ain't no discipline going on. What is the number one job of a black parent? The number one job of a black parent in racist America is to teach your sons discipline. And what is Dr. Umar's definition of discipline? It is the ability to do what you don't want to do when it gotta be done, whether you like it or not. That is the purpose of discipline. And the reason why black boys in Las Vegas represent 80% of the expulsions is because in a black household, when you tell your son to do something and he don't do it, there's no consequences. In the black household, he can talk back to his mother. In the black household, he can tell his father where to go. In the black household, he don't even have to respect the consequence you gave out. And so you create this illusion in your son's mind that he can do to white folks in school what he do to his black parents at home. And when he get to school, and those racist white teachers who could care less, the first time they tell him to do something and he don't do it, here comes the suspension. And God forbid he threatens somebody when he's angry. Because I want all you black parents to do something when you go home tonight. You wake your children up. You wake them up in the middle of the night. I don't care if they first graders, third graders, fifth graders, or ninth graders. And you tell them, you better never threaten a teacher. You better never threaten a child. You better never threaten to destroy school property, because if they do, they will be expelled from school. Black preschool boys are being expelled from school more than white high school boys. And you know why? Black folks still fail to understand that in America, black males are not allowed to be black boys. Let me say it again. In America, a black male is not allowed to be a boy. White supremacy will treat your 3-year-old son like he's 30. White supremacy will treat your 10-year-old son like he's 25. White supremacy will treat your 17-year-old son like he's a 40-year-old grown man. There is no adolescence for the black boy. And I need you mothers to understand that, because every time you let your son get away without suffering a consequence, the more you have just empowered him to go to school and think he can get away, and it's not gonna happen. See, the problem with school is, in order to properly teach a child, you gotta love him. In order to really teach a child, you got to love him. And we got too many teachers who don't love the children that they're teaching. And when if there's no love in that classroom atmosphere, if there's no compassion in that classroom atmosphere, if there's no empathy for the child's life outside the class in that classroom atmosphere, then the child's natural motivation to do his best will automatically wane and die. Because no child is going to try unless they know the teacher cares enough to catch them if they fall. Brothers and sisters, I want you parents to be real careful about getting your children evaluated for special education. As a school psychologist, this is what I do for a living. And I want y'all to know special education is a trap. I want y'all to know special education is a hustle. I want y'all to know special education is a racket. And I want you to know special education is the school-to-prison pipeline. Under no circumstances, Las Vegas. And before you leave here tonight, I'm gonna give you my personal cell number. So any parent having an issue with their child and you need Dr. Umar to look at that evaluation again, or look at that IEP again, or look at that 504 plan again, or look at that behavior intervention plan again, you can reach me yourself. But most of you will never reach out. You know why? Because truth be told, white folks don't care about black kids. But not too many black people care about him either. See, I always say, if a black child got a teacher who care and a parent who don't, he's likely to make it. If a black child got a parent who care and a teacher who don't, he's likely to make it. If a black child got a parent who care and a teacher who care, he will make it. But too often across the great state of Nevada, we got black kids who got teachers who don't care and black parents who couldn't care less. Which is why, if it was up to Dr. Umar, we would not diagnose the children. We would diagnose the parents they come from. If it was up to me, we would never put a reading disability label on a little black boy. We'll put it on his father. We'll never put a math disability label on a girl. We'll put it on his mother, because guess what? A child can't fail until a parent failed them. Brothers and sisters, you got to help me understand why a child needs an IEP in order to learn how to read when Frederick Douglass taught his damn self. Somebody help me understand how we got ancestors who taught themselves how to read under the threat of death, and your son can't learn with all these books in Las Vegas. Something's wrong. Let me tell you a little secret. When a psychologist brings your child in the office and we sit your son or daughter down and we give them an intelligence test and a reading test and a writing test and a math test and an emotional test and a psychological screening and a visual motor screening and adaptive behavior assessment, and we observe him in the classroom and we interview the parents and we interview the teacher and we look at his records, none of those tests tells us whether he's reading disabled or not. None of those tests tells us whether she's math disabled or not. None of those tests tells us whether he got ADHD. None of those tests tells us he's emotionally disturbed. Did you know the tests don't do the diagnosing? There's no test in the world of psychology that diagnoses anybody with anything. The diagnosis is made by the psychologist. What is your point? My point is, when you get your child tested for a learning disability, and that psychologist, that evaluation team, that special ed team comes back and say, Raheem has a reading disability, that's not a scientific fact. That is a working hypothesis that those white people came up with about your child. Take your child to another psychologist and it's not a reading problem, it's a math problem. Take them to another psychologist, it's not a math problem, it's an anxiety issue. Take them to another psychologist, it's not anxiety, it's depression. Take them to another psychologist, it's not depression, it's an intellectual disability. The point that I'm making, the diagnosis is only as good as the evaluator making it. Well, I don't believe him. There's no blood test to prove a learning disability. There's no x-ray to prove a learning disability. There's no CAT scan to prove a learning disability. There's no MRI to prove a learning disability. It's a man-made condition. White folks made it up to brainwash black parents into thinking your children can't learn as well as the white ones. And I want you parents to never fall for the trap of getting a kindergartner, a first grader, a second grader evaluated for learning disabilities. How can a five-year-old be reading disabled? How can a six-year-old be math disabled? How can a seven-year-old have ADHD? Have you seen the definition of ADHD? Can't sit still, taps with his hands and feet, acts like he's driven by a motor, loses things necessary to get his work done, can't play quietly. What child plays quietly? Do you know what ADHD is? ADHD is the demonization of traditional black male alpha behavior. public schools are ran by women. Boys are young men. When boys go to school and can't sit still like girls, they're automatically considered abnormal. And we as a black community has bought into this narrative that says if a boy can't act like a girl, something's wrong with him. Very few black male teachers have ever referred a black boy for an ADHD evaluation. Very few male teachers have ever referred black boys for conduct disorder evaluations because we understand that hyperactivity is not a disorder, that's God-given power and strength. Which is why I refer to ADHD as what it really is, brothers and sisters. Ain't no daddy at home disorder. And why do I call it ain't no daddy at home disorder? Because over 70% of black boys diagnosed with ADHD don't have a consistent father figure in their life. This has nothing to do with psychiatry. This has nothing to do with psychology. This is a war against black men that sends the fathers to the penitentiary and their sons to the psychiatrists. Black mothers, I need you to stop believing everything the classroom teacher tells you. That's right. That's right. Some of y'all be looking for special ed. I want them tested at 6, tested at 7. You know why? Because you're too damn lazy to make them practice at home. You know why? You're too lazy to check homework at night. Know why? I had a black mother come into my office one day. She said, Dr. Ifatunde, you don't know what you're talking about because his father wasn't special ed, his uncle wasn't special ed, his brother wasn't special ed, I was in special ed. She said special ed runs in the family. I said, well, guess what? I said, special ed don't run in your family. You know what runs in your family? No homework runs in your family. Poor parenting runs in your family. Not going to school runs in your family. Not going to report card conferences runs in your family. Your son is not in special ed because of a genetic link. Your son is in special ed because of the intergenerational transfer of failure and mediocrity. That's what's wrong with the black community. We are comfortable with underachievement, not just with our children, but with ourselves as adults. I'm trying to understand how we always running around worshiping Black Wall Street. Everywhere you go, black people talking about Tulsa, how great it was, and it was great. We talk about Wilmington, North Carolina, how great it was, and it was great. We talk about Rosewood, Florida, and Charleston, South Carolina, and how great it was, and it was great, but that was over 100 years ago. If you love Black Wall Street as much as you do, then somebody explain to me why nowhere in this United States, 50 million Africans spread across 50 states, and you don't have a Black Wall Street nowhere. Not a single city where we own the school independently without no white finance, the bank independently without no white finance, the hospital independently without no white finance, the supermarket independently without no white finance. You know why? Because even though we are $2 trillion people, even though we the richest Africans on the planet Earth in terms of take-home pay, even though we're the wealthiest black people in the world, slavery did something to us that led to a dysfunction in our behavior. Slavery took from you and I. Slavery stole from black people the natural God-given desire to want to control your destiny. And this is why black people so comfortable letting the Latinos gentrify your community. This is why black people so comfortable letting white folk miseducate your children. This is why black people so comfortable spending $30 billion a year on hair and weave products. $30 billion a year. Black woman, do you know that your weave, hair, and wig bill is more than half the countries in Africa have to operate on for the whole year? And that's what you spend on weave, hair, and wig, because for 400 years, the white man that made our black women feel so insecure about the way she looked that she spends one-third of her disposable income trying to enhance her beauty. Black men, $2 billion on Air Jordans every year, but our boys ain't got no schools that they can go to. $1 million on McDonald's, and our elders are dying in racist hospital beds. $800 million on chicken, turkey, beef, and pork, financing your own cancer. All these college degrees we didn't got, all these government positions we didn't achieved, all these black millionaires and billionaires we got, but what good is any of it if your mind is just as under control of the white man now as it was 400 years ago? Las Vegas, nothing will ever change for Africans in America until we change the way we think. The psychological revolution is the most important one. We talk about reparations, and I support reparations, and we will get reparations, but my problem with reparations is you want the white man to repair his damage, but you don't want to repair your own. Do you realize we got problems money can't fix? The black man and woman's issue with one another, no dollar can fix that. The black woman's lack of appreciation for her God-given beauty, no money can fix that. The black man's unwillingness to stand, fight, and die for his people, no dollar can fix that. Half of our psychopathology cannot be repaired with money. It can only be repaired with sacrifice. I tell you, let me get my towel one time. And to the black man of Las Vegas, and for my non-Africans in the room, you're not being disrespected. I understand there's exceptions to every rule. So I'm not chastising any non-African, but I would at the same token say that if the shoe fit, you might as well wear it. To my black men, I'm very ashamed of you, because as I've driven around Las Vegas in this short time, I'm seeing too many black men dating non-African women. So let me be real clear. Let me be real clear. Any Negro male who don't see beauty in his own woman, any Negro male who don't see attraction in his black woman, any Negro male who don't see God in the black woman, any coon in Vegas who can't love the black woman ain't worthy of being called a man. Quote me on that. We talking about fighting for the survival of the black family. How the hell we gonna talk about fighting for survival of the black family when you wanna take your hard-earned wages over to another woman's community? Haven't they stole enough? Haven't they robbed enough? Haven't they killed enough? So you're telling me what all the hell we done been through with white folks for 400 years, you want to go and wife one up? Get the hell out of here. And black woman, don't you follow suit with what the brother is doing. Because some of y'all say you want to get a bunny. I'm going to go get a puppy. And that's just as unacceptable. Because the black woman is the mother of civilization. You are the first being that God put on earth to bring forth life. So you are the living manifestation of supreme consciousness. You are God incarnate. And for a black woman to spread your wings and let your slave master inject his ancestors into your heaven. Because you do know when you make a child, that's the coming together of two families, two DNAs, two sets of ancestors. So do you really think Harriet Tubman want to have a cookout with Adolf Hitler? Do you really think? Do you really think Marcus Garvey want to sit down with Thomas Jefferson? Why would you force our African ancestors who have already been traumatized enough to be re-traumatized by your self-hatred? Why would you make your womb an incubator for white power and privilege? I have nothing against the white woman. I have nothing against the Asian woman, the Latino woman. Most of the Latinos are Africans hiding under Spanish language anyway. I have nothing against any woman of another race. But I'm concerned about the survival of my own. And one thing we're going to have to get right, black people, if we're going to get back to glory, is we have to stop feeling insecure about putting our people first. And if your religion doesn't allow you to put black people first, then your religion cannot be in the service of God. It's in the service of white supremacy. Have you noticed? We're the only people in America who have to go one place to pray and another to solve our problems. Why is that? You can go to the church and worship God, but when you say, let's talk about police brutality, the pastor say, you can't do that here. Let's talk about the gentrification of black Las Vegas. You can't do that here. Let's talk about economic apartheid in Las Vegas. You can't do that here. So how can you tell me that you are a servant of the Lord when you're comfortable with your people living in hell? Brothers and sisters, black religion has been one of our biggest problems in the post-Dr. King era. And what makes the black church, not all of them, because I'm a descendant of pastors, there's a few exceptions. But generally speaking, what makes the black church the enemy of black people is the black church has a tendency to deify your oppression. The black church has a bad habit of making black people think the reason you ain't got nothing is because God set it up that way. The reason your kids are being miseducated is because God set it up that way. The reason white folks in charge is because God set it up that way. And I'm here to tell you, God didn't set it up that way. White folks set it up that way, and you have allowed him to keep it that way. See, the God I serve doesn't serve me. Because that would make God my creation. The God I serve works through me, not for me. So as long as Las Vegas sits down and does nothing about what's happening in your city, you will continue to suffer. See, God is not in a rush to save black folks. And one of the reasons God is not in a rush to save black folks is most black folks just want to be free so they can imitate white folks.
If we want to be absolutely honest, half you Negroes in here tonight ain't got a problem with white people in charge. You got a problem with the position white people in charge gave you. See, there's a big difference between being free and being freed. Free people want to stay that way. Freed people never taste freedom, so they can't value it. So black people have transferred and traded in freedom for some of the luxuries of American society. So you don't mind white folks running your life as long as you got a nice car. You don't mind white folks running your life as long as you got a house in a white suburb. You don't mind white people running your life as long as your child can go to Harvard. See, we got to search our soul and ask ourselves, are we praying to God because we want to be divine, or are we praying to God so we can do a better job imitating the devil? Black parents, don't you ever sign those special ed test agreement. Don't sign that paper unless you have a conversation with me. And if it has anything to do with a reading or math disability, don't you sign it at all. Most of your children go to Title I schools. Title I money is money that comes from the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, 1965, Lyndon Baines Johnson. He sent money into the schools to help poor children with reading and math. So can I ask you a question? If most black kids are sent to special ed for reading and math, and every school in Las Vegas just about gets Title I money for reading and math, why isn't the principal using Title I money to get the reading and math scores up? Why are they sending your child to special ed? It's because they're using the Title I money however they choose. And they're using your child for special ed. See, every time I put a kid in special ed, the school gets extra money. See, once I say speech and language impairment, once I say blindness, once I say deafness, once I say autism, once I say hearing impairment, intellectual disability, reading disability, traumatic brain injury, orthopedic impairment, multiple disability, other health impairment, the name goes into a computer. It goes to the state of Nevada Department of Education. And by the end of the month, an electronic transfer of funds is sent to the school district in the name of your child. So let's do the math one time, Las Vegas. You got a second grade boy who you let them evaluate and classify as reading disabled or emotionally disturbed or intellectually disabled or math disabled. Your son is in the second grade. So let's say hypothetically in Las Vegas, they spend $10,000 a year per pupil. Once I say he needs special ed, he's not worth $10,000 no more. He's worth $20,000. And guess what? They get the extra $10,000 every year he stays in special ed. So if your son is in the second grade and he got 10 more years until he graduates, $10,000 extra dollars times 10 years is how much? $100,000 for one black boy. 10 black boys, $1 million. 20 black boys, $2 million. How many black boys in special ed in Las Vegas? What is the Las Vegas special ed budget? Let me ask the question another way. How many racist white teachers is living in the suburbs off the fact that you let white folks tell you your children can't learn as well as anybody else? Which is why I'm not a fan. No disrespect to the other groups, but I'm not here to talk about them. I'm a black man, and I speak for black people, and I speak for black people only. I want what's best for the Latino children. I want what's best for the Native American children. I want what's best for the Arab and the East Indian and the Anglo-Saxon children. I don't want nothing bad to happen to any child.
But when I speak for my own, because none of these other groups have ever come to the defense of black children. Not one of them. Not one of them. Not one of them. Not one of them. White folks don't ever fight for our kids. Brown folks don't fight for our kids. Yellow folks don't fight for our kids. And red folks don't fight for our kids. So when I speak, I can't take no time away for the white, the yellow, the brown, the red, because I'm too busy focused on the black. See, in order for your child to get special educated, you got to sign your name four times. So stop saying, they put my child. Tell me what you did. Because you have to sign permission for the psychologist to test. That's me. Then you got to sign agreement with my evaluation, claiming your child is reading disabled or worse. Then you have to sign the IEP, incarceration preparation agreement. And then you got to sign the special ed service agreement. So you signed your name four times before your child start getting special ed services. Yes. I wish I could break your finger that you used to write. Listen, even when we come over to ADHD and conduct disorder and ODD, and by the way, conduct disorder ain't nothing but Caucasian disorder. Black boys get tired of being treated like animals, so they fight back. But guess what? If your son is in special ed for ADHD or conduct disorder or ODD, guess what that means? That means you took your child to a clinic or a hospital, had him evaluated, diagnosed, and then you brought the evaluation back to the school. Because as a school psychologist, I cannot evaluate for mental illness. ADHD, conduct disorder, ODD are not special ed disabilities. Those are clinical disorders. So if your child is in special ed for ADHD, it's because you talk too much. You went and got them tested, and then you brought the report back to the white folks and told them that we hate black people mental health services of Westside Las Vegas. Said Raheem got ADHD. And you know what's sad about the ADHD boys in special ed? Most of them ain't ADHD. Guess what I found in my work? I've been evaluating kids for 25 years. They not ADHD. Most of them are mentally gifted. The reason they goofing around and playing around is the work is too damn easy, so they can't stay focused. And because you don't really believe in your child, it never even crossed your mind that he's not off task because he's a problem child. He's off task because the curriculum is too weak. Oh, yes. Do you know the research from the White University says teachers pay more attention to the children in the class who look like their own children at home? So if the teachers are mostly white and they pay attention to the children who look the most like their own, what about our dark-skinned daughters and our dark-skinned boys? You don't believe me? Go into any classroom in West Las Vegas. Look at the special ed class and then look at the gifted and talented class. You will see a clear complexion difference. Yes, it's true. And don't act surprised because we still got a light skin supremacy problem in the black community. Oh, yes, we do. One of the biggest psychological residuals of slavery is the light-skinned supremacy complex. But let me clarify. Because you're light-skinned doesn't make you a light-skinned supremacist. In fact, in my experience, most light-skinned supremacists are dark-skinned people. I'll give you an example. Clarence Thomas, Supreme Court Justice. Blue, black, purple, nappy hair, just like mine. But he's married to George Bush's cousin. He's in love with white folks, and he can't stand his own people. Although he's chocolate, he's a light-skinned supremacist. Light-skinned supremacy is not about your complexion. Light-skinned supremacy is not about your complexion.
It's about the complexion you prefer to have around you. Black parents, when the school complains about your child's behavior, don't assume they're telling you the truth. Teachers lie on black children. I live it. You cannot assume Mrs. Sloffenberger is telling you the truth. And black mother, black women, y'all be making a real big bad decision. Guess what it is? Y'all like turning your child's classroom teacher into your personal life coach. And now you telling all your business to your child's classroom teacher. You done told them things nobody should know but you. And guess what they do? The minute you don't do what they want you to do, put them on drugs or special ed, they go to the principal, Dr. Schwarzkopf, and they tell him that Shaquita was in here today smelling like marijuana, alcohol, gin and juice. And the next thing you know, Child Protective Services is knocking at your door, threatening to take your children away if you don't put them on psychiatric medication. First of all, when the child services show up at your house, number one, you don't have to let them in. Number two, I would not let them in until I see ID in a business card. Number three, if I know I'm totally innocent, I might make them come back with a warrant from the police. Number four, do not answer questions from any Child Protective Service worker until you get the name, phone number, and email of their supervisor. As soon as you're done talking to the Child Protective Service worker who showed up at your house, make sure you call or email their supervisor as soon as they leave your house. You can only counteract them by giving their supervisor another narrative. If the supervisor don't hear from you before they hear from that worker, or if they don't hear from you at all, then all they have to go off is what the worker said. I'm gonna tell you something else. You better make sure you let your children know that they have a right to plead the Fifth Amendment in public school. Did you know that? Yes, your child's constitutional rights come with them to school every day. So if your son is questioned by the principal and the dean of students and the school of police as to whether or not he was smoking marijuana, he could simply say, I plead the Fifth. I refuse to answer any questions until my mother and father are present right here. You better teach him that. You better teach him that. And when the school calls you and say, we're going to question him with you on the speaker, you say, uh-uh. You're going to wait till I get there because you need to see the body language. You need to see any intimidation. Because if your child answers questions without you being there, that principal can take whatever they say and use it against your child and even lie against your child because he didn't have any witnesses. Brothers and sisters, as I prepare to wrap up, I want to say that we as African people better learn how to work together or we will perish separately as fools. The white power structure has come up with a new way to push racism on blacks. They don't do it in white face no more. They do it in brown face. They do it in yellow face. They do it in red face. They use the other groups as an argument against us. And one of the reasons we gotta stop letting people call us people of color. And one of the reasons we gotta stop letting people call us minorities is because when you allow them to lump you in with the other groups, you give them the ability to give all your resources to the brown, yellow, red, and white. You get nothing. If I go to City Hall, Las Vegas, and say, what percentage of the contracts went to black people this year? They'll say, we gave minorities 20% of the contracts. I didn't ask you what you gave minorities. I asked you, what did you give to my people? But because you're so comfortable being lumped in with non-white people who hate you, let's be honest. Nobody likes black folks. Let's just be honest.
But the first thing you go doing with your low racial self-esteem, people of color, people of color, people of color. It's all about people of color. Where were the people of color when Trayvon Martin got snatched? Where were the people of color with Amir Pope? Where was the people of color with Breonna Taylor, Sandra Bland, Philando Castile, Alton Sterling, Freddie Gray? Where were the people of color then? The only time the people of color show up to be with black folks is when they see an opportunity to claim some resources for their community. And the minute they get finished using you, they act like they never knew you. Brothers and sisters, I want to bring this to a close. Take out your phone so you can take my cell number. I'm going to come back to Las Vegas because I have to do my Black Parent Boot Camp. It's a 12-hour training that teaches you how to be an advocate for your children. If somebody has a space we can use for free, we can expedite that training and do it in the next 2 months. My cell number is 215-989-9858. I'll repeat it twice. 215-989-9858. Once more, 215-989-9858. In conclusion, I want to say thank you to all my brothers and sisters across the state of Nevada who stood by me this past 9 years while we were building the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey Academy. And we will be having a grand opening in April or May. The Garvey building is complete, brothers and sisters. Thank you for your support. Thank you for sticking with me. Thank you for keeping it real. And if you want to work at the school, send me your resume. We need science, we need language, we need math, we need social studies, but we need African martial arts, we need music, we need art, we need food, we need agriculture. Send me your resume. But black woman, if you're gonna work at the school, you gotta come to work 100% nappy by nature. No weave, no perm, no European hair color, no straightening comb. I give you this quote from Frederick Douglass and I end. My family came to America in 1701, a black man named Bailey, stolen from Nigeria. He was brought to Talbot County, Eastern Shore, Maryland. He married a black woman named Selah, for whom my 11-year-old daughter is named. 1745, they had Grandma Jenny. 1774, they had Grandma Betsy. Grandma Betsy was born enslaved. She married a free black man, Grandpa Isaac. 12 children they had. One child was my Aunt Harriet. Another child was my 5 times great-grandmother, young Betsy. These 2 sisters were raped by Aaron Anthony, the white man who owned our family. As a result of the rape, Aunt Harriet gave birth to the greatest black leader in American history on February 14, 1818. My grandmother, young Betsy, gave birth to his half-brother and first cousin, my 4 times great-grandfather, Stephen Henry Bailey, on July of 1819. Frederick and Stephen were cousins because the mothers were sisters. But they were half-brothers because the slave master raped those sisters. Grandpa Stephen married Grandma Caroline. They had my grandfather George, the first black public school teacher in Denton, Maryland, hometown of Harriet Tubman's parents. Grandpa George married Grandma Manny. They had Grandma Caroline. She moved to Philadelphia. She had Grandma Vivian. She married Grandpa Cicero from Cuba. They had my grandmother Ida, who we just passed away 4 or 5 years ago. She met and married James Johnson. They had my father Jamal, who met and married Barbara, and on August the 21st in the ghettos of North Philadelphia, I was born. Frederick Douglass said, if there is no struggle, there is no progress. Those who profess the faith of freedom and deprecate agitation are like men who want crops without plowing up the ground. They want the rain but can't stand the thunder or the lightning. They want the ocean but they're scared of the roar of the wave. Frederick said, for 20 years I prayed on my knees to God for freedom. But the good Lord gave Frederick no freedom until I got up off my knees and prayed with my feet. He said, if you want respect from the white man, why do you choose pity? The man who pities you will never respect you, and the man who respects you has no need for pity. The most honorable Marcus Garvey said, without confidence in self, you are twice defeated in the race of life. With confidence, you have won even before you have started. Marcus Garvey was once asked, are you an African or are you a Jamaican? Are you an African or are you a Jamaican? And the leader of the largest black organization in modern history said, you ask me, am I African or am I Jamaican? And I tell you, I would never give up a continent for an island. I am an African. Black power, Las Vegas!
Give it up. Have a seat right here. I'm gonna take a picture with you. Give it up for Baba Umar Johnson.